great. And you, Anita?
You got your little shoulders going. You had your little shoulders.
Yeah. Yeah.
And hello, movers. How are you doing tonight? Hello, prophetess. The prophetess is there in there. We got to bow for the prophetess. The prophetess.
Yes. Oh, yes.
The prophetess is in the house. Hello, Prophetess Sharon Green. Hello, everybody. It's so good to see you. Thank you all so much for tuning in. You have tuned in to Can We Talk, brought to you by Movement Worldwide. We are a motivational organization there to educate minds, empower, nurture, and transform. We are a movement to move. Yes, we are a movement to move, helping others thrust into their purpose to live the best version of themselves and win. We've tapped into some winning information. We have some winners' resources. We're seated at the winner's table, and we invite you to sit right along with us, right, Annette?
Yes, that is correct. We come every week and we have this table. And I'm telling you, it's one of those tables you see in mansions, you know, where it's just long and all kind of chairs. And all you got to do is pick a chair, pull up, and come sup with us.
That's it. Just choose a chair, pull up, come and sit with us, come sup with us, come chat with us. Come just, you know, hey, come just listen, just chill, hang out. This is what we do each and every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. live on Facebook and YouTube. And we're always saying this too, because it's like, you know, the saints used to say this all the time. So we always say this because, you know, Annette says a bunch of chairs. We got room for la-di-da and everybody. And we always invite you to come where the table is spread. And the feast of the Lord is what, Annette?
Guano.
Guano. You know, she said guan. She went island on y'all. It's guano. Well, the feast of the Lord is guano. We like to kind of imitate or talk about our elders and how they used to say that all the time. I used to hear them say that, come with the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is going on. I mean, they said it with an attitude too. And they move their head like Sharon, the prophetess. The prophetess move her head like this with something good. Prophetess be like, girl, he preached this thing. She get that head going. So listen, we're glad that you stopped by. You could have gone anywhere else with your time, but you chose to come here and have a conversation with your favorite co-host, myself and Annette L. Anderson. And we're so grateful. And we just thank y'all. We love y'all so much. You guys are so awesome. But before we get started with our conversation, we want to ask that you do a few things for us. You're watching this video either on Facebook or YouTube. We ask that you please hit the subscribe button, that you join, you subscribe, you whatever it is you got to do. We ask that you hit that button and that you subscribe, you join, I think you have to join our Facebook page, but you can like our Facebook. No, you join our Facebook group, but you like our Facebook page. For YouTube, you subscribe. So listen, just subscribe. Like, hit that thumbs up button, hit the heart button, whatever you got to do, heart, like, love, hug, whatever you want to give us, hit that button. And then there's an arrow that's called share. We ask that you hit that share button and you can share this broadcast. You can copy that link on YouTube and you can share it to your Facebook page. I'm sorry, you can share it to your text message. You can share it in email. You can share it to WhatsApp. And on Facebook, you can click that link and share it to your page, and you can also share it to your DM. You can DM people. I do it all the time, 2 and 3 times sometimes, and people are like, yeah, you shall do. You send it to me all the time, and I'm like, I just got it, and she sent it to me in a group, and then she sent it to me. Yes, I do. I send it to Lottie Dottie and everybody all while we're talking, all while Annette's talking. I'm still sending out because I know that there's somebody that wants to get involved in this conversation. They just don't understand it yet. They just don't know it yet, or they just haven't been invited yet. So please click the subscribe, like, and share button. The other thing that we ask you to do, you can sow a seed. We are a nonprofit organization. Every seed that you sow into this ministry, we always pray that it returns to you 100-fold. So you can sow a seed via Cash App. Our Cash App is $Movement Worldwide. Or you can actually sow Zelle. Our Zelle is info@movementworldwide.org. Or become a patron, which is a monthly covenant partner. And the way you become, how do you become a patron? Annette, you know, it's just every week we get these great questions.
Yeah.
And that is one of the perfect questions. How do you become a patron? Well, all you have to do is go to our website, movementworldwide.org. There's a red button that says become a patron. You can go to patreon.com via that button and you will be able to set up your account, set your amount. We ask for $12 a month. That's just 40 cents a day, $2.80 a week. Most of our patrons do an amount when they sign up for more than we ask for. And we are greatly appreciative. But guess what? Any amount is greatly appreciated. But you know what's mostly appreciated, though? Is your presence, your ENCE. Now we need your ENTS, your presence, your gifts, your seed. We need that because we have to accomplish things. We have to do things. But we also know that without your ENCE, we wouldn't be able to do what we do. So we love and need your presence. We need you here with us and sharing and telling everybody what we got going on here at Movement Worldwide. So please, ma'am, please, sir, sow a seed. You can also, everywhere that you see that globe that is above Annette's head, the one that's over there, boop, 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 boop. Everywhere you see that globe and the acronym, follow us on our social media platforms. And you can also email us your thoughts, views, comments, praise reports, prayer requests, topic ideas, everything to info@movementworldwide.org. Now, without further ado, I'm going to go to our conversation. Now we come every single Wednesday night with a threefold conversation. Somebody say threefold.
Oh, come on.
Threefold. Come on, say it. Threefold. Say that.
Threefold.
You better say it, girl. Threefold. Threefold. So we have a threefold conversation. We start off with the idioms and phrases and quotes and topics, those things that just make you go, that makes sense. Yes, something so practical, something so simple. And we like to take that phrase and we just like to share it and have a conversation. So that's what we're going to go into first. And that one is called our transformational topic. Our transformational topic. So tonight we have a great transformational topic that I didn't see this one coming. I didn't see this being what it was when I first started talking about, you know, thinking about this particular topic. It's been a while. And I pulled it out tonight. I was like, where was I going with this? Because, you know, sometimes, you know, because we make up these a lot of times ahead of time. Like one time we did them for the whole year, a couple of times.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And I know I do mine. Like I have so many listed down that we created like last year. And I'm like, wow. And then when it comes up on a time, it's always right on time.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how sometimes Annette and I, how we link. But our topic tonight is home is where the heart is. In 1939, there was the making of a film that became one of America's favorites, one of the most popular films to date. And it was done in black and white and then eventually made in color. One of the most famous lines in this film was of the one of the characters. She was lost. And at the end of the movie, she's clicking her heels together three times and saying, there's no place like home. There's no place like home. There's no place like home. Well, the sentiment of this expression, this quote, whatever you want to call it, is generally attributed to the Roman naval commander. His name was Gaius Plinius Secundus. That's a lot of names. Gaius Plinius Secundus, known as to the historians as Pliny the Elder. Now, his years that he was on earth was AD 23 to 79, go all the way back to 23. Yes. So when we look at this particular phrase, it's been around a long time. And it's also when we look at scripture, talks in this along these lines a lot. But when you think about it, your home will always be the place that you feel the deepest affection for. No matter where you are, it's like, I can't wait to get home. Mm-hmm. I can remember traveling when I was touring, when I was working as a singer. I was touring a lot. And you would think that because I was touring and traveling all over the world, that I was as happy as a lark, that, oh, this is where I want to be. I'm in Paris. I'm in London. I'm in Australia. I'm in blah, blah, blah. But baby, about a month or two, three, you know, it's like, and especially when you're on a different continent. I don't know anybody who's ever like traveled abroad like a lot, but when you're on a different continent and you're literally walking around in another country, you realize I am so far away from home. Like, can't nobody come and pick me up. I can't call and say, can you come and pick me up? Can't do that. No, I have to get on a plane or a boat or something and get back to where I'm from. So home is where the heart is. And what this means is that home is a place where we feel the deepest affection, and there's something special about being home. Whether it's the feeling of being safe or comfortable, our home is technically a place of refuge, somewhere that we can go when we want to be alone, or we just want to be with our family, or we want to let our hair down and just relax and be us. When we walk inside, there's nothing like being greeted with a familiar welcome. Oh, I'm telling you, this is food for the soul. So here's the thing. We should create our earthly home as a place of peace and refuge because it represents what we are headed for. The Bible says that Jesus is our shelter, our rock, a refuge, our dwelling place. And when we hear people, you know, the old saints say this a lot, and that we don't hear this a lot where people, they will say, well, he went home to be with the Lord. You know, we have gotten very refined now, and we're saying, she transitioned. He transitioned. And they used to say, well, I'm going home. Yeah, well, she went home. And that's what I remember when President Obama's grandmother passed. She passed like 2 days or a day before the election was finalized, whatever. And he said, well, she went home. I'm like, wow. And I had not heard that saying in such a long time because very few people use it. Now, we'll put it on our program, Homegoing Celebration, but we won't just say that the person has gone home. And home is where we feel the deepest affection for. And if Jesus is our dwelling place, our place of refuge, that is where our heart should always be. You know, the Bible says that he's our shelter, our rock, refuge, our dwelling place. He is our resting place. Psalms 90 says, thou, Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. And the word dwelling place in the original Hebrew language means refuge or shelter from danger or hardship. I know that I can always find peace. I can always find joy. I can always find refuge. I can always find comfort. I can always find answers when I go back to the place of my heart, where my heart is. And when you truly have a heart for God, when you truly have a relationship with him, then you understand that if your heart is not in it, you can't fake it, because the truth will always show up. Or it will come out of your mouth, because the Bible even says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you're bitter and mean and angry and don't really believe, guess what? That's what's going to come out of your mouth. But when you believe and you know and you understand the importance of your dwelling place, the importance of your refuge, the importance, then you understand home is where the heart is. I always know that when I'm in trouble, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. I will lift mine eyes into the hills from whence cometh my help, because I know where my help comes from. And when you know you at home, there's a calm. There's a peace. That's why we call it our sanctuary. Woo! I love that. When you come home, it's your sanctuary. That's why you should take care of it. Keep it clean and comfortable and peaceful and keep the mess out. And all the, my mom always said, don't bring them spirits up in here. So when I think about that, my heart gets so wound up about a dwelling place. And that's where I took my word from. Y'all know I like to take a word and I deal with it from a transitive and intransitive tense, a verb from our topic or from something that relates to the topic. And in our topic, there wasn't a word that I could relate to. And I was like, wow. And it was in the scripture. It's dwell. The word dwell, the verb, only has one tense. Now, a transitive verb needs an object to make sense. An intransitive verb just makes sense by itself. It makes sense without one. So this particular word, when I look at the word dwell, it is only intransitive, which means it just makes sense. And what that word means is to live as a resident. I'm putting my residency in right here. Where? I am in the secret place of the Most High, because I understand that when I go there, that's where my refuge is. That's where my protection is. That's where my peace is. When I go home, I feel safe and comfortable. So I'm going to be home in my house. I'm going to be home with my Savior. And when my life is done on this earth, I will be home with Jesus, period. And that is our transformational topic. Your thoughts?
I was thinking when you were talking how when you're going to, we went on a cruise recently. And one of the things I was adamant about, make sure everything's in place. Mm-hmm. I don't want to come back to disarray. I'm going on a vacation. I'm enjoying myself. When I want to come in this house, I just want peace. and even as it is in the natural, so it is. I always say so it is in spirit. Same way we have to do with our earthly house. We got to clean that thing out. We got to start praying and reading the word. And so we can make sure that our residence, as you say, is a place that you're glad to be in. It's so many people can't even stand being in their own skin. They don't like their life. They don't like this. They don't like that. But there's a peace that, if they could ever get to that peace that surpasses all understanding, then they would know. So anyway, when I came back from the cruise, I came in, put my suitcase down, and everything was just like clean. I like, oh my gosh. So I know if I had left the house in a disarray, which of course I would not have, then it would have shifted my spirit, man, because I've been all annoyed because of how it was in disarray. And so this is how we have to get in our lives, to get our life in order. And, you know, so we always in disarray. We always mad. You know, Native people never talk to people. I don't care. They never say nothing nice. They always in disarray. They just need to clean up their temple. They need to clean up their residence. So, you know, so they will have a place of peace. And so their home will actually really be where their heart is. And a lot of times when people are disarray, that's where their heart is. It's in disarray, you know. So that we got to get that heart right. And you said something out of the abundance of the mouth, the heart speak. See, I think y'all be, we all think we're quiet. No, baby, that heart speaking.
Oh, yes.
It's saying some stuff. You may it's not always bring it out to your mouth. Oh, but boy. Like that's why I tell God, oh, change my heart. Oh, God. You know, so, but yeah, that was really good.
Yeah. All righty then. Well, that was our transformational topic for tonight. Home is where the heart is. And before we go to the next phase of our conversation, we're going to pause for a moment and have our Can We Talk toast. Get your Can We Talk mug so that we can toast you. Boom. And then, oh, I was going to say, and then they got her mug. Bam. There we are, nice and skinty. Ooh, we look so good. Ooh, sitting there having our tea. Yes. So that was our transformational topic. We pray that it blessed you as much as it blessed us. And right now we're going to pause for a moment. We have a quote from the heart of the quotologist herself, from Annette L. Anderson. Quotes, poems, books, short stories, whatever you want to call it. She comes to us each and every week with something very special and profound. So we're going to pause for our Annette-ism, and then after that, we'll come back with the next phase of our conversation. You can still share while we are away. We'll be back in just a minute.
The peace that one feels in the time of difficulties can only be explained by the uncompromised presence of the Lord. He dries your tears. Even when you want to continue to cry, He lifts up your head. Even when life's problems have caused you to be downtrodden, He directs your footsteps. Even though you walked in the wrong direction for so long, He leads you by the still water. Even when the turbulence of life seems to overshadow you, He caused the storms of life to cease so that the sunshine will dry up the waters that has drowned out your blessings. This is the peace that surpasses all understanding. I am walking in the peace of God. This is Annette-ism's expression.
Okay.
I wrote two of those and then two of those and I sent the wrong one. But anyway, it talks about peace. I was like, wait a minute. I said, yeah, but we're talking about peace tonight. I guess I got a thing about peace. I wrote a couple of things on peace. But anyway, so we're going to get started. I was looking at it, I'm like, okay, Annette, you better skip some lines there. But let's go. Let's get going with the power tool. There are some matters and experiences that causes people to become hurt, fractured, or broken spiritually and emotionally. Sometimes it just takes a conversation to mend the broken heart. And Anita talked about the heart earlier. Broken heart of spirit. In some cases, a band-aid won't do it. You need a power tool.
Power tool.
All right. Well, tonight I am going to be speaking from these words. It kind of go along with what we talked about last week, but then it wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up. In other words, we're totally consumed. Sometimes life has us totally consumed. I remember when I was growing up, I used to sing a song, they wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up in Jesus. You know, in other words, they were saying, I'm totally consumed by the presence of the Lord. But tonight I just want to talk about the soul ties, the soul. You know, the soul, it means to breathe, to blow, which is the root of the English word psyche or psychology. A soul is a psyche, a person's distinct identity. I talked about identity last week, I think it was. Your unique personhood, an individual personality. At its core, soul ties refer to deep spiritual bond formed between individuals, transcending the physical plane. And this is something, this is deep. This is why I know a young lady is like, she is so consumed with this man. It just boggles me. This connection can vary in intensity and depth and can be healthy or unhealthy and can span throughout the course of your lifetime. We can think of it as a physical cord or tie that connects two people. Soul ties are a concept that is not really mentioned in the Bible, but it alludes to it. But the idea is derived from various passages that describes the spiritual and emotional connection between people. You have to be careful with the connection you make with people. The Bible speaks of souls being knitted together and becoming one flesh, which it talks about being married. And sometimes what we don't understand, even when we are with someone that's not our spouse, or you know, we are having sexual relationships, and you connect into that person. And sometimes I wonder, even in my own life, because I have been connected to people, did that cause me to the way I think and the way I look at things to change? Because I found myself later on in life starting to change and acting a way I would never act. Soul ties can be formed in many ways, including through sexual relations, close relationship, idolizing someone, vows, commitments, and agreements. I see that a lot of times, even though how people get so caught up with singers and even with the former president, I'm like, are y'all for real? Well, you be so consumed with this, it becomes a part of your life. I see people riding around with all kind of crazy stuff on their car. I just saw this guy. He had a beautiful truck. I mean, the top of the line truck. He got all kind of Trump this and Trump didn't line up. You know, all kind of foolishness. So if we're not careful, we get caught up and entangled into stuff that really, at the end of the day, really don't make no sense. And people are so consumed with it. It's like the air they breathe. 1 Samuel 18:1 says this, and it came to pass when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, and the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David. So there was a connection with that. Now people try to take that and twist it to be some type of perversion, but sometimes you are close to certain people. There are times that, you know, like I talk to Anita a lot, I talk to Sharon every day. And I have other friends, you know, of course, I got a handful of them. But some people you're just closer to, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about that you get so embedded and engrossed in them. Because this young lady I know, she divorced this guy, and she still, I mean, it's like she said, "Oh, he's my soul. He's my soul. He's my soul." I said, well, that's kind of dangerous, because if he's your soul tie and he treats you like a dog, I don't understand that, because there's a danger when there's a emotional manipulation, when you have a soul tie with someone is emotionally manipulating you, causing you to act crazy. I see so many women, and I'm just going to go there with us. You know, okay, there's one little rusty man, and about three of y'all fighting on. Trust me when I tell you, there's somebody else. They was always more men than this one. Oh yeah, that may be, but just that one, y'all going to be just going crazy. I was looking at, and I never watched Tasha K, but I just saw a little clip of one of her shows where this woman had years ago. Had her and this guy was and this little girl was beefing about the same little rusty dude, and she threw a lie in the girl face, and the girl is totally blind. And I'm thinking that, and she, of course, she went to prison. And I'm thinking, was that worth it? You know, all that fighting and carrying on. That's crazy soul tie. When I see it on these shows, I'm like, really, y'all? I know you're making big money. I know you got a lot of zeros in your bank. But when you later on in life, you're gonna look and say, "Boy, was I a fool?" You know, I've been manipulated. I had emotional soul tie with my ex, and I'm like, wait a minute. See, but my soul tie really became a little dangerous, because I went from being emotionally manipulated to mentally thinking how I'm gonna kill him in multiple ways. See, so that soul tie, you see it all the time, but God, thank God he delivered me. I told somebody, I said, oh Lord, I was gonna be a preacher and preach in prison if I had a follow through on my ideology, thank God. But then there's a toxic relationship, a soul tie with a toxic person can be harmful to your mental and emotional health. Toxic people can drain your energy, make you feel stressed, anxious, and depressed. Oh my God, anytime you're in a relationship, I remember one time, oh my God, I was in a relationship, I was married actually to my former husband, and I got off from work, and I thought to myself, oh my God, I can't go in there. I just drove by my house, and I just kept driving, and I kept driving around. You know, so it was a toxic, it was a soul tie, but it was so toxic. Then as the mental torment, unhealthy emotional soul ties can also torment your mind. You can find yourself constantly thinking about other person or feeling negative emotions that you don't usually have. Soul tie can cause you to think of things that you shouldn't even be thinking about. Things how you hurt somebody. And I say, God, I begin to pray, because I'm telling my story, because I was connected, and it was not a good thing. It was a mental, and it was toxic. And so what will happen if you're not careful, it could lead to a place of doing bodily harm. Some people wig out, some you know, people lose their mind because they is so entangled in a person. It's the worst thing in the world to have a soul tie and you're the only one tying. Mm-hmm. You got a soul tie to that person, but that person cares nothing about you. And that could be good or bad. I mean, you know, but you connected so to that person. You know, so Proverbs says this, my son, if sinners entice you, do not give in to them. Do not go along with them. Do not sit your foot on their path. And so when you see that starting to become, well, you become almost overzealous, almost crazy. Because I mean, this young lady, I know she is totally bonkers. You know, it don't matter. And I'm serious. Don't matter what nobody say. It's a soul tie. It's a soul tie. And it's not just her. It's just I've encountered several people. Heck, I was one of them. You know, and I was like, God, please. I mean, I was delivered. Thank you, Jesus. But it, that thing is real, y'all. And we try to wonder, well, I can't shake that. I don't know why I still think about him. I still think about her. That soul tie. You know, especially when you're tied by yourself, because a soul tie should be you, that person, and God. But sometimes it's just you. God and that person ain't either. You know, so we have to be very careful. Hebrews 2:8 says this, thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under his feet, and he left nothing that is not under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. So in other words, there are so many things that we have put under his feet, but a lot of things we're holding on to because we feel like that we got to have what we got to have. And what happens, Anita, we get tied and wrapped up, tied up and tangled up, totally consumed. Then we have no life because our whole life is being consumed by somebody else. This is why people, we talked about this on one hour, a couple of weeks ago, about this man had got get so consumed with these women, and he would follow them, and he would do, you know, just craziness. And that's how people, a lot of movie stars and singers, you know, they have these people driving by their houses and breaking into their houses, you know, because in people's mind, soul tied, you have pastors who are single, and about 20 women in the church say God told them he their husband. Well, I mean, like, he can't marry all y'all. So people get so caught up in things, and they get wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up. And what happens with our life, if we're not careful, mm-hmm. our whole life will be totally consumed with something that really has nothing to do with the path that God has set before us. But we get wrapped up. Wrapped up means it's like putting on a blanket, how you do a baby when a baby's born. They swaddle the baby. They tighten the baby up wide so the baby can't move. You know, and that's why we are. Some of us are so wrapped up, we can't even move. Tied up, we're getting tied up. It's like taking a rope and tying your hands together. You're trying to get loose, but you can't. So if your hands tied together, that means you can't do the work you've been called to do. And tangle up, you get just as tangled up. I watched a movie, I like sci-fi, and you know, it was a big spider, and this person got caught up in the spider web, and it got all tangled up and couldn't get out. And then of course, the end was the spider took care of him. So this is what happens in our life. We get totally consumed by life, and I had to learn it, and I chose this topic tonight because I've been the wrapped up person, I've been the tied up person, mm-hmm. and tangled up, and I totally been consumed. But thank you, God, that I've been delivered, and I went through this for years, and I didn't know, but God, you know, He healed me. Thank you, from the emotional, the toxic, and the mental torment. And you know, and that's why you can't sleep, you can't have eat, you're mean, you're hateful, and the list go on and on, because you need to be delivered from that thing, to be delivered from whatever that may thing that may have you wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up. And that's it for me tonight.
Wow. You know, you reminded me of something with this tonight, and it's something that I've studied and preached about a lot. First of all, dealing with soul ties, God knows we are. Oh, Jesus, thank God for deliverance. But when you talk about soul ties, not only is it an emotional connection, but it's a spiritual connection. So your emotions and your spirit just tied up and twisted and tangled up. And I'm reminded of the information that I studied. I used to love Clarence Larkin's book on dispensational truths, and where he deals with the threefold nature of man being body, soul, and spirit. And how from the body, we have sight, smell, hearing. Well, we have our eyes, nose, ears, mouth, and our touch. Those are our senses, which is sight, smell, hearing, taste, and touch. And so then when we go to the next realm, from the carnal realm to the natural realm, which is the soul, our psyche, we have our imagination, conscience, memory, reason, and affection. And that's where we get so caught up with the soul tie. And when something connects to our soul, because it comes through from those gateways, and if it gets into our spirit, where our sense faculties are faith, hope, reverence, prayer, and worship, it becomes a mess. So when it's a emotional and a spiritual connection, and you've put something or someone in a place where they don't belong. And that's the danger of it. But when you can, oh my God, when you can be delivered from that thing, you really, it's almost like you feel like you take a deep breath that you've been choked for a long time and didn't realize you were choking. And it's like you gasp and like, and it's like a weight lifted off of your shoulder because you feel better. So I know how it is when you've been tied to something for so long that you think it's normal, but it's not. It is not normal and is not healthy, but it's a hard thing to convince somebody else of, because of the fact that they have been so wound up and tied up from their with a soul tie that they think that they misconstrue the soul tie for being something real, and ain't nothing real about it.
Not real. It's not real.
Amen.
And they will, Anita, you and they will be abused, and people take advantage of that because they know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in relationships and you fighting and cursing, Lord, no.
It makes no sense.
None.
It makes no sense to go into the battle zone with something that's not real. You just don't realize it's not real yet. And when you, some people in that spend 10, 20, 30 years.
You really do.
I mean, chasing after, we always using a man, I'm sorry, y'all. Chasing after a man that will never be theirs. I mean, and then I've seen some people chase a man for years and then get him and wish they had left him where they got him. Because I can't remember who said this. It took you 5 minutes to get him in your house and 15 years to get him out. Because you were so determined to have something that you didn't realize was not spiritual. It was a soul tie. That was not sent by God. It was sent to destroy you and distract you from the real deal that's supposed to be in your life. So thank you for that. I appreciate it. Wrapped up, tied up, tangled up. My God, today. And I don't want it. The only thing I want to be wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up in is Jesus. That's it, y'all. That's it. Woo, that was good. Thank you so much for that. Powerful, powerful. Oh my God, that's a hard one. Talk about ripping the Band-Aid off and having a hard to have conversation. That's a hard one because nobody wants to admit it, Annette. People don't want to admit when they know they're in something they have no business. I'm talking about not just male-female relationships, but friendships, jobs, churches. Come on.
Friendships, too. Mm-hmm. And we did the ship thing. But friendship, you can have toxic friends.
Oh, my God. Just a full toxic load, a toxic relationship with a person that you think that, and you got the unmitigated gall to call them friend. And, you know, there's some things you just have to let go. Then you wonder why you can't get to where God's trying to get you. Because you're wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up. That's why. And God don't have your ear. Your soul tie does. Woo! Oh, that'll preach by itself. That'll be a series.
Oh, yeah. That's a series right there.
Yeah, I got my Sharon hit the mark. Woo! Get my prophetess head rock on. You'll preach your face off with that in it. All right, good people. We're going to move on to the next phase of our conversation. That was our power tool. We've had our transformational topic. We've had our power tool. We're going to move on to these topics. But before we do, we're going to pause for a moment for our commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to slide right into the topics. You know, we got a lot to talk about. Don't go anywhere. Invite somebody. Tell them, come on, talk some trash. Because we love it when y'all be talking, when y'all leave them comments. Ain't nothing like the comments from the movers. So we'll be back in about 2 minutes, y'all.
Walk into your God-given destiny with power and conviction with Power Walk Sunday. Each and every Sunday at 10 a.m. live on multiple platforms.
When we eat well, we live well, and all will be well. Go to elbwell.com, join the journey, and take your life back. TNT, that's Tuesday Night Talk with the Andersons, each and every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. live on multiple platforms. For more information and other services, visit AnnetteLAnderson.com. Your faithful co-hosts, Annette and Anita, along with the best mods this side of heaven, are live on Clubhouse in the Movers and Shakers house with Operation Manifestation every Friday night at 8 p.m. You don't want to miss this fiery conversation. If you don't have your copy yet, get yours today at Amazon.com. That's Living Life One Quote at a Time by Annette L. Anderson. Another milestone reached. Get your copy of The Wow Effect by Anita Faye Wilson, available on all platforms, or you can visit AnitaFayeWilson.com. And you can always catch us live on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for Can We Talk? Join us with your Can We Talk coffee mug. Get yours today. They're $15, and that includes shipping. So good seed into good soil. You can sow a seed into Movement Worldwide via Cash App at $Movement Worldwide, Zelle at info@movementworldwide.org, or by becoming a patron. You can visit our website at movementworldwide.org, click the red button, go to patreon.com, and set up your account today. And remember to follow us on all platforms. Like, subscribe, click that notification button, and don't forget to share. It's that time. Tea Time Topics.
There we go with our Tea Time Topics. Tea Time Topics. Tea Time Topics. Say what? Tea Time Topics. Come on now. Ooh, ooh. Get it, Net. Ooh, ooh. There you go, girl. Oh, ooh, okay. Ooh. Ah, ah. Ooh,
ooh. That's it now. That's all I got.
Yes, ma'am. With the Tea Time Topics, my favorite part of the show. So we're going to dive right into these topics. We got the tea, as always. Boom. Wow, this is cray to the cray, y'all. That this right here, man, crazy, crazy, crazy. All right, pulling it open. The former Minneapolis police officer who was convicted of murdering George Floyd was stabbed in an Arizona prison on Friday. Derek Chauvin is expected to survive. The recent prison stabbing attack he was involved in, authorities said. Earlier this week, Chauvin, 47 years old, the former Minneapolis police officer who was convicted of murdering George Floyd, was stabbed. Chief Brian O'Hara and a spokesperson for State Attorney General Keith Ellison's office tell people in statements that Chauvin is on the mend. Citing his agency's federal law enforcement partners, O'Hara said that Chauvin was in stable condition. Brian Edison and Ellison spokesperson, meanwhile, said that the attorney general's office heard that Chauvin is expected to survive as of Friday evening. No employees were injured during the incident. A statement from the BOP read, responding employees initiated life-saving measures for one incarcerated individual. Emergency medical services were requested while life-saving efforts continued. The incarcerated individual was transported by EMS to a local hospital for further treatment and evaluation, the statement concluded. According to the BOP, the FBI has also been notified of the incident. Back in July 2022, Chauvin pled guilty to federal charges of violating the civil rights of Floyd, a Black Minneapolis man, by keeping his knee pressed on his neck during a May 25th, 2020 arrest, which resulted in his death. Wow. That is something. I'm not shocked. Oh man, she just said exactly what I was thinking. I was trying to get to the screen. Said exactly what I was thinking in this comment here. And I agree. I'm with you. I'm surprised it took so long for somebody to try it. Your thoughts on that?
Because from what I gather, he's only let out 1 hour a day. Mm-hmm. And I'm sorry. You know, he's still, you know how I am about a soul. He's still a soul, but right. I got a feeling some gods may have turned their back.
Girl.
You
how in the world?
Huh?
How in the world did somebody get to him?
You know, I know people are clapping and carrying on, but that ain't gonna bring George Floyd back.
No, I'm not rejoicing in him.
Oh, not. I'm just saying online and stuff.
Yeah, but I know people comments. I read some of the comments. They're ruthless, and I get it. You know, people are still angry. You know, he got a very hefty sentence. He did.
Surely did.
And I'm surprised that it took this long for somebody to even try it.
Yeah.
And but then for them to actually get to him says a lot. Yeah.
They haven't released who the inmate is.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, at the end of the day, he's somebody's child.
Our
prayers go out to his family.
His mom. I guess his mom's still around.
I mean, honestly, he's where he's supposed to be.
Oh, yeah.
100%. I do, you know, pray that they're able to keep, you know, all prisoners safe. I mean, I have a nephew in prison.
No way.
The last thing I would hate to have something like that be an issue because I've, you know, dealt with some families that have had to deal with that before, with a loved one being killed in prison. Mm-hmm. It is not a pleasant thing. And I don't wish any ill on anybody, and none of us should, but it is something. And it's a trip. I'm really, my biggest shocker is not that he got stabbed. My biggest shocker is that it took so long for somebody to try it. And it's like, wow, finally somebody tried it. That's crazy, because I expected them to try to get him long before, which they probably have. Exactly. We don't know. But anyway, we don't have a sound for him because.
No.
So we're going to go on to the next topic. Come on, fellas.
Moving. We keep it moving.
Okay. I love that bitch. She's so pretty there. With powerhouse pipes that are raw. Force of nature. Hey, I don't have a problem reading the day. What's going on? Shaka Khan was born to wear. So it's hard to imagine that she wasn't the first choice to be the female voice of Rufus when the influential interracial funk band made its self-titled debut, wow, Anita, 50 years ago. Mm-hmm. Wow. When I started Rufus, Paulette McWilliams had quit. She decided to quit and go solo on a business set con of her sister. Oh, okay. In the Chicago music scene. But a serendipitous, look at that, we're right, twist. Mike Whedon recommended Khan as her replacement. And I said, this is my chance because I really want to play with the band. I'd seen them a lot and they seen me a lot. So I happily joined the group pretty quick. 5 decades later, after going from the fierce front woman of Rufus on hits such as Sweet Thing and Once You Get Started, one of my favorite songs, to fulfilling her solo destiny with the 1978 anthem, I'm Every Woman. Khan was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame at Brooklyn's Barclays Center on November 3rd. And having been nominated 7 times before, 4 times with Rufus and 3 times as a solo artist. And wow, in the performing category, her musical excellence award is overdue recognition for the queen of funk. Wow. Mm. So she had 7 times and finally.
Mm-hmm. Well, hey.
Yeah, I seen some negative stuff. I don't even say everybody be on social media as haters. I think they're just instigators. Because they're not all haters. They're just instigators, mm-hmm. and they'll say something to get the narrative going. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. But, yeah, 50 years, listen. And she looks amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing.
Thing, at the end of the day, it should have been long ago, in my opinion. But,
yes.
I mean, I love her. I think she has really served her career in considering her, you know, her early life was very rough. I mean, because she was still beat out of her by her husband. And I had a friend who actually used to play in her band. So there was, you know, and then of course she was a friend of Betty's. I've been in sessions with her before, and it's just her gift is just unparalleled. Even at her age, you know, she still is kind of a force to be reckoned with. She got her own little thing, but you know, she might be a little old with it, but she still got it though. Still got it. So I'm happy for her. And we do applaud, you know, her getting it after 15 years. You just don't know. You don't know. You don't know when the blessing is going to come. You don't know when the elevation is going to come. You don't know what's going to happen. And we can't always, you know, a lot of times people will count it out. We'll count it out like, oh, it's done. It's over. This is never going to happen. And you have no idea. So you just have to, you know, you just have to hold on and believe God. And I know it's, you know, some people, once you get it out of your mind in that, and this is how it happens sometimes, when you get it out of your head, when you get out of your own head.
Yeah.
And you move out of the way, that's when God can actually do some things.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's what, you know, sometimes totally. That's when the blessing comes.
That's
when
true.
You get out of your own way, period. Period, point blank. So we love that. Thank you for that. All right, fellas, come on, take us to the next one.
Moving. We keep it moving.
Ugh.
I-
God, this chick. Wusa, Wusa, Anita, just Wusa.
Yeah, but her day coming. Yeah, her day already came, actually.
Yeah, her day took, but she got a piece of a day. Candace Owens learns the hard way that she's free to bash Black people, but not Israel's invasion of Gaza. Candace Owens lost support from a group that helped launch her career bashing Black people after her comments about Israel-Gaza war receiving a rebuke from David Horowitz, the founder of conservative anti-Islam group David Horowitz Freedom Center. Horowitz wrote in a statement accusing Owens of comparing Israel to the South during segregation and implying that the Israeli government is committed genocide against Palestinians. He also commended, condemned Black Lives Matter for what he calls ignorant apartheid state slander. Horowitz stated he discovered Owens on YouTube before he became a national figure after meeting Turning Point USA founder Charlie Kirk at a DHFC event. The 84-year-old continued by saying he is now so disappointed in what she has become. Horowitz added that Owens, obsessed with her own fame and playing the victim for financial gain and publicity, her comments about Israel and her promotion of people like Andrew Tate are a part of a pattern. Candace tackles a subject she knows nothing about, never bothers to learn anything about it, and then rides the backlash by playing the victim to generate more fame and money. X users reacted to the news on the former Twitter platform and noted the irony of Owens being condemned by the group. "See how racist they all are," wrote one. "They funded her talking about Black people, and now they are trying to silence her when she's talking about them." Candace Owens has been dropped by David Horowitz Freedom Center, all right, which helped put her on the map. Horowitz ended his statement with, "Goodbye, Candace. We will continue to support those who truly strive to raise up the movement for liberty and life, not selfishly tear it apart." Wow. Now, them some strong words.
Yeah. Yeah, but she said, I mean, she said they would commit genocide. And he got bent out of shape. But it's kind of funny to me. So it's all right as long as she was, you were saying this stuff about apartheid, a state slander about Black Lives Matter. But when it comes to talking about Israel, well, no disrespect to Israel because I support them. But so what's the difference between them and Black Lives Matter?
Okay.
It's still people who has a cause. Now, if I hear one more person say, well, about the N word, what a rapper said, but I ain't no doggone rapper. And the truth of the matter is most Black people are not rappers. So don't go there with that foolishness. I'm so sick of that. I can scream. But so as long as George Floyd, y'all talked about him, when you saw it, the man murdered him. We all saw it. Mm-hmm. But now somebody going to say something about Israel. Well, let me clutch my invisible pearls. What? And as far as Candace is concerned, who cares? She getting just what she deserved in it. And they ain't through with her. Because when it comes to talking about Israel, they will, man, she may wake up one day and she don't have she has to create her own little platform. Yeah.
Listen. Candace had so many people behind her, and oh, she was just on top of the world. Now she's sitting there looking for her followers. Uh-huh. Like,
yeah. She's wonderful. Ooh, we like her. Oh, yeah. They always gonna find them a little Black girl and a little Black boy to come and say stuff that other Black people don't agree with. So you can always find somebody like Candace. Well, yes, she after money. Y'all didn't have he didn't have no problem with her trying to get money until she said something about Israel. You know, that's her. Okay, that's her opinion. She had an opinion about George Floyd, and she had an opinion about Black Lives Matter. Now she got an opinion about you. You 84. When I saw his age, I said, that's one of the problems right there. Because what they did 84 years ago, bro, we don't do that now. So that's one of the problems right there.
At all.
You know?
Period. Man, so, well, that's what you get, Candace.
That's what she get. She knows she better not say nothing about Israel group. Ooh, boy, they
your mouth a little too much now.
You talk too much. That man said, you ain't trying to learn. And he didn't either, because if he, when you slamming Candace, but you didn't learn anything, because if you did, you wouldn't have said that stuff about Black Lives Matter. I don't care about those people who took the money. Every organization, we got a former president bleeding y'all dry. So let's not go there. It's just so silly. So I don't have no sympathy.
None.
Look, and she compared it to she compared it to something. That's why they met. That's why he mad.
To the South.
Yeah, to the South. Oh yeah. That's why. That's the real reason.
Mm-hmm.
That's the real reason.
Like, what? Excuse me.
Yeah. What? Yeah.
All right, fellas.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Okay, this chick here. A 23-year-old Pennsylvania woman was sentenced to decades behind bars in connection to a drunk driving incident that left two state troopers and a pedestrian dead last year. Jayana Webb is set to serve a 27.5 to 60-year sentence. Little girl, after pleading guilty to homicide by vehicle, she should have got a different lawyer, while driving under the influence and 3 counts of third-degree murder on Wednesday. Because I've seen a bunch of little white kids getting off on this. The Associated Press reported, during this time, the trooper's attention was redirected to a man attempting to cross the highway while assisting the pedestrian, Miss I.K. Reyes Rivera, 28, Webb drove past the park. Now listen here. Girl, she drove past the park police SUV at high rate of speed, striking all 3 men who died at the scene. Ooh. Oh boy. Webb, her alcohol level was more than 2 times the legal limit during the fatal collision, and active components of marijuana was discovered in the system, according to the Philadelphia Inquirer. Due to her being 7 months pregnant, she reportedly won't be sent to prison until she gives birth and spend time with her newborn. While in court, she apologized to the families of the victim impacted by the incident. She had hoped that at some point in their lives, they would be able to forgive her. Girl, they ain't gonna never forgive you. She would never forgive herself, she said. Okay. She suffers greatly because of what she did, and recognized that she is punished and has ruined a large portion of her life. Previously, now this is where they got this chick here. Webb previously bragged about reckless driving before the incident. And in one tweet posted by the New York Post, she wrote, "If you ask me, I'm the best drunk driver ever." Mm. She received a significant amount of backlash on X, formerly known as, I don't care about that.
That makes
okay.
sense.
Yeah, one, you know, this, and they were saying this is one of the most shocking incidents.
A vehicular homicide.
And recently, and she up there bragging, girl.
If you don't sit down somewhere,
so you going away? I see she got, you know how the little girls wear their little hair all slicked down, baby. I don't know if you're going. I don't know if they got no jail and stuff. Jail, they may. I don't know. But she gonna be she gonna be there.
Fuck a buzz gonna be sticking up.
Girl, listen.
You got your little baby hairs right now, but when you get behind them bars, them little cuckabuzz gonna raise right on up.
She killed 3 men to set your tails on drunk.
Though, and the thing is, and I agree. Connie said something. Let me go back to her comment. I agree with her on part of it. She said, you can't kill people from driving drunk and black. You can't.
So,
she should be in prison. They went in on her, but they were cops, though. And that was the deal, because she killed cops. It's like, girl, you should have known that was
a deal.
You didn't stand a chance, maybe.
Stand a chance, because I've seen several white kids, I hate to say it, that have killed people and they're still around. I've seen several that's been arrested 3 and 4 times for drunk driving. They finally say, that's it. You ain't never giving that. I don't care what color you are. They sick of you. Oh, man. Boy.
Well, darling, our hearts go out to you. And, you know, you got to serve your time. You did the crime. You got to serve your time. We don't have a sound for you, you know. It's sad that you killed cops and somebody else and all this
stuff. But stupidity.
And you know what? These kids don't think, though. They don't think. They don't think about the consequences for their actions. They just act. They just do, act, and they don't think about what they're doing and who they're impacting. It's this generation. It's something. I'm telling you, this generation is really, you need a lot of prayer, honey. A lot of prayer. All right, fellas, come on, take us to the next one.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
All righty then. We have a brave soldier here. Republican Representative Ken Buck laid into his own party Sunday, blasting those who continue to propagate the lie that the 2020 election was stolen for lying to America. Wait a minute, Annette. I just had to pause for a second and get my chuckle on because it's about to... Oh my God. It's just funny when you think, when you actually think about it from this perspective, that finally somebody's speaking. They're gonna ask them too. Everybody who thinks that the election was stolen or talks about the election being stolen is lying to America, the Colorado Republican said during an interview in CBS Face the Nation. Everyone who makes the argument that January 6th was, you know, an unguided tour of the Capitol is lying to America. Everyone who says that the prisoners who are being prosecuted right now for their involvement in January 6th, that they are somehow political prisoners or that they didn't commit crimes, those folks are lying. What are they doing? They are lying to America. They are lying, which means that they are liars. They are lying, period, point blank. Homeboy say they are lying to America, period. Man. He says, too many Republican leaders are lying to America, he said in his announcement video earlier early November. Buck didn't name former President Donald Trump, who was brandished lies about the 2020 election and elevated January 6th rioters, calling them hostages earlier this month on his seemingly runaway road to the GOP presidential nomination. But he pleaded with his party to defeat President Joe Biden with someone who's not lying to the country. I hope all of my Republican colleagues become more clear and recognize the fact that Joe Biden is an existential threat to this country. We need to defeat him, and we do that with someone who is not lying to the country, Buck told CBS Margaret Brennan. Johnson took over as Representative Kevin McCarthy was ousted in an effort led by a small fraction of Republican hardliners, including Buck, who were unhappy the California Republicans sought help from Democrats to pass the stopgap bill to keep the government open. Though Johnson was forced to do much the same earlier this month, Buck said Sunday, he doesn't expect he'll face the same blowback as McCarthy. I don't think that most Republicans blame Speaker Johnson for the problems that he's now facing, the challenges he's facing. Those were created during the McCarthy time period, and Speaker Johnson is doing a good job to work his way through those issues, Buck said. So no, I don't think he's going to face rebellion, unhappy the California Republicans sought help. Oh, sorry, we got a little typo there. Though Johnson was forced to do much the same early this year, Buck said, those were created during McCarthy's time period. That's it. I'm going to stop right there.
Yeah, stop because it's
good. Yeah, it's a little, we got some little repeat things going on here in the notes. My bad. Sorry about that, y'all.
My bad.
Yeah. Proofreading is fundamental.
I knew it. I should have done it.
But yes, so... Finally, you know, but my thing is like, you know, what's going to happen to him?
Well, he must be not coming up to be elected. He probably recently got elected. You know how they do them 6 years, so he probably good.
Probably somebody's not afraid of the former of Peach Man, of Orange Man, Agent Orange with the concealer. Finally, somebody speaks up. I mean, listen. It takes more than that. And Pope Governor Christie, he keep trying to say stuff. And it's like, anybody listening to him? And I was so disgusted last night watching a clip of Haley talking about, guess who's in second place? I'm like, baby, you like 30 points behind him in second place. I wouldn't even be bragging.
I don't know what she, I don't understand what they think will happen. Now, there are more people coming out. Cause every time somebody disagree with him, well, he just shut up. You in the lead. Why do you feel every time somebody come out and say they supporting somebody else, you got something to say. You in the lead. Mm-hmm. They're not, you know, but he can't, I mean, he can't help himself, child.
No,
I'm like you. What is she bragging for? Trouble.
Well, I'm glad somebody spoke up, so I'm going to give him a little something.
Oh, yeah.
Some of your statements.
Yeah. It's almost like you're going to tell me what I did not see. It's almost like you, because the Trump used to do it too. It's that game they play. They figure if they keep saying enough that it's going to change the narrative. Mm-hmm. Well, one thing about history don't care what you say. History record what happened. So
records what you do. And what you did was what was done. And all of those folk were criminals going there to fight and to try and kill and hang the vice president and everything else, period. Then he knows it, and they stop lying. It's like, what are you
lying? And then you're gonna send we're gonna show what all the, you know, they send in a video. Boy, stop. It don't matter. It wasn't that many. I don't care.
You gotta climb the walls for a tour. You gotta break the windows for a tour.
Yeah. Well, most people know, we know everybody didn't get in the building, but enough of them did.
Lot of them did.
A lot of them got in the building. Stop it. And they'll be saying it straight face. I thought to myself, I pray when y'all go home, you repent. Because y'all are pathological liars.
Liars. Period. The
people broke in there. Over 1,000 people been arrested. Stop. Oh my gosh.
All right, fellas, come on. Take them off stage.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
All righty here. All righty. A 23-year-old Pennsylvania woman was sentenced. No, that's wrong. My apologies. Girl, I don't know what's going on today. What am I doing? What's going on? Oh, here we go. All right, I got it, y'all. The domino continues to fall for Diddy following his initial rape lawsuit with Cassie. We said that last week that he's getting ready. Yep, we just said it. The billionaire was handed a second and third sexual assault lawsuit over the weekend. Oh, my goodness. On Thanksgiving Day, CNN reported a woman named Joe Dickinson Neal alleged that Brother Love drugged and assaulted her while she attended Syracuse University in 1991. Baby, they're going back to when they were babies to get you. Per the report, the two went out to dinner, and the I Need a Girl artist slipped a drug into her drink while she was in the bathroom. As they were in the car leaving the restaurant, he allegedly pressured her to smoke a blunt. Girl, let's move on with that one. She claims upon arriving where he was staying that evening that he sexually assaulted her, recorded it, and showed the footage to multiple people. Mm-hmm. Why you go home? Another woman, unnamed, came out on November 23rd and said that she was also sexually assaulted by Bad Boy founder NBC News reports. She claims that he and R&B singer Aaron Hall both took advantage of her at Hall's apartment, but it was unclear as to whether it took place in 1990 and 1991. The third assault lawsuit also claimed that Diddy visited her home days later, assaulted and choked her until she passed out. The mogul was allegedly looking for her friend in an effort to keep her from telling the girl he was dating about what he had done. Okay. Diddy's ex-girlfriend was the first person to start this string of lawsuits. The former couple settled a lawsuit just 2 days later for an undisclosed amount. Diddy's legal team released a statement clarifying that the settlement did not mean he was admitted to any guilt in this situation. So he stepped down temporarily from what his organizations. And I heard that...
He's losing. They're pulling him out of stores and out of. He's losing a lot of. Okay. I think we're still on. Y'all give me a minute. Let me see if we're still on here. Okay, I think it's me. I'm still on. But Annette apparently is not. So I'm just going to continue the conversation. Okay, it looks like she lost her stream. I think she's back, but it's audio only. You got to turn on your camera, Annette, if you are going to come back in this feed. Y'all bear with us. Y'all know technology does some strange things. But yeah, I don't even know if she is hearing me. But I'm gonna keep going with the conversation. So she will be back when she can get her stuff straight. But the thing is, when we look at this whole thing with Diddy, there were so many people when the Me Too movement first started. There were so many people that were coming out of the woodworks, and they were, you know, were coming out of woodworks with stories. Now, I'm in the music industry, and I have seen and experienced a lot of things. Now, I've never been taken advantage of or anything like that because I've never put myself in a position to be handled like that. However, I know of many people that have been and who have shared with me. Okay, look like you're back in it. I know of many people who have been and who have experienced those types of things, and they're, you know, they were afraid to speak out back then. I mean, back then people didn't care. Now people care. Now people are doing stuff about it, just like what used to happen with Black people getting beat up by police officers and killed by police officers. There was a time that everybody just turned their eye and like, well, you know, ain't nothing gonna happen because they're a cop. Ain't nothing gonna happen because they're a cop. Well, those days are long gone because that's not happening anymore. And the same thing with men and women, but, you know, I'm sure there's some women too, but of course, let's be honest, this is predominantly men slipping stuff in people's drinks, taking advantage of them, all of the rape and assaults and stuff that are happening. That stuff happened, y'all. The music industry, the film industry with Weinstein, that stuff is so real. It happened. And a lot of times, even the Bill Cosby stuff, you know, I can honestly tell you this. I know of people who have been in situations where they have been faced with that they've been faced with situations that they feel like they have to compromise. That's the word I'm looking for. That they have to compromise in order to get ahead in the business. And a lot of them did it. They did it knowingly. Now, I'm not saying that everybody who will slip some Spanish fly or Quaaludes or whatever in their drink or whatever, that they deserved it. No way am I saying that. But I do know, and I know some people who actually drank the Kool-Aid, for the lack of a better phrase. They did it intentionally, knowing that they were compromising themselves, but that they did it so that they could get ahead. So it has happened. And then it has happened where it's been people who did not go into that with the intentions and were taken advantage of and raped and assaulted, et cetera. And so the things are coming out now. We're in a day and age where everything is seen. I mean, everybody got cameras, you know, all this stuff. So we're in that day and age now, and people are reaching back. I'm telling you, they're reaching back and say, okay, you did this to me, you did this to me, you did that to me. So I know there's a bunch of them shaking like a leaf net.
I know they are. And, you know, it used to be the old good old boys club, and they got away with some stuff. They really did.
Not anymore though. So heart goes out to you, Diddy, bro. But listen, I know that this is not even the end. It's just getting started. So be careful. That's all I got to say. As the saints used to say, watch and pray. All right, fellas, come on, take us to the next one.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
All righty then, we're winding down here. A Black financier filed a $900 million lawsuit against the oil company ConocoPhillips. Neyland Youngblood claims that the oil company profited by ignoring his family claim to the land bought by his ancestors in 1889. Y'all can't keep taking people's stuff. You can't keep taking people's stuff. Period, point blank. The Wall Street Journal reports that the 67-year-old filed a lawsuit on behalf of the descendants of his ancestors for royalty payouts against the white family who claim they are the owners of the Eagle Ford Shell Ranch land in Karnes County, Texas. I ain't never heard of that right
now. Me either.
County, Texas. All right. Youngblood is a Princeton graduate and the founding partner of Farrell's Capital Group, an investment firm with over $1 billion of dollars of assets under management. Jesus. Right now, $1 billion of assets. Youngblood told the outlet that his great-great-grandfather, Lewis Eckford, bought the ranch land after he and his wife, Eliza, were freed from slavery. After Eckford died in 1896, half of the 147.5-acre tract of land was left to his wife, and the other half passed to his 9 children. When Eliza passed away, white money lender from a nearby ranch, Fritz Korth, secured a deed trust on the land as payment for a $300 loan Eliza had taken from Korth before her death. After none of her children claimed the land following her passing, the land passed to the Korths, who now claim that the Eckford children's shares were also bought by Korth. Korth paid $735.50 for part ownership of the land in 1939. However, a Texas jury confirmed this summer that the Eckford family co-owns the land, and Youngblood decided to sue to ensure his family receives the oil royalty payouts that they deserve. Amen, amen, and amen again.
Yeah.
Korth's great-grandson, Chico Korth, claims that because his family paid taxes on the land and their name is on the deed, the land belongs to his family. It seems very straightforward that if you pay taxes that you're and you're operating the land and you have a deed that stipulates that you are the owner of the land, then it's yours. Well, bruh, the court has spoken and you need to get in their money.
And they knew it. And you see the table, they paid $300, but you took, because it was, a hundred and something acres, and she had half, so $300, so you just took it. Mm-hmm. But y'all didn't understand that we're going to be down the line, there was going to be a black brother who already wealthy himself. He don't need the money. And he said, I don't need the money. I'm just making sure that, the people that come after me will never have to worry.
Amen.
Yeah. They make it in that on that property, making millions of dollars on that property.
Look,
yeah.
Listen, if Neela was my cousin, then that. Be straight up like that dog when I think about Jesus and all he done. I'll be straight up shouting, where my cut.
Mm-hmm. And they've been doing that.
They've done it for years, and it's
for happened years. Just take it, and then in Orlando over there where they built the big stadium, they just went in and just bought up. Somebody called me today. I had to tell her, don't call me no more. What? Oh, you sell your house? Did I advertise I was selling it? What they try to do is buy up stuff because they see the change. Mm-hmm. But the devil's a liar.
Bottom line.
Anyway, I hope they win.
Well, I'm glad they. Hey, listen, I am glad they get theirs. I give them the things up and the applause. Point blank. All right, fellas, come on.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
Okay. All right. Zoe Orley had trouble accepting herself in her natural hair. Zoe shared with her mom that she felt different than her other classmates with straight hair and what she described as pretty hair. Her mom, Ivana Orley, decided to soothe her daughter's anxiety and encourage her to see who she truly is by purchasing. What? Pronounce the word. Her a black doll that reflected her own appearance. Zoe really loved the doll, but she noticed that she didn't have hair like hers. When her mom returned to the store and couldn't find any dolls with curl, Zoe then decided to do something about it. Zoe asked her mama if they could make dolls and she and other girls like her could relate to, and beautiful curly me was born. Dream big, work hard, and never give up. You have to believe you can do anything you set your mind to. And no matter how hard it gets, there's always a way forward. Zoe told GMA, not only does beautiful curly me help empower girls around the world, but for every doll purchased, the company donates one doll to underprivileged girl. Oh man, that's awesome. Beautiful Curly Me also offers a gift a doll program for those looking to purchase a doll for another child. I want Beautiful Curly Me to be a global brand and to create spaces for girls to play, learn, and get empowered. Zoe said, this is a little girl saying it. The brand has expanded to include satin, sleep caps for kids and her doll and their dolls, books, and more. To follow along to Beautiful Curly Me journey, check them out on Instagram or visit the website.
Oh,
so yeah, so she has done some great things with that with that brand, and I like the fact that they're giving back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just not just.
It's, I mean, that's a nice story, and I'm glad that, you know, she took the initiative to do it. And this is, you know, I posted a comment, but I'll say it. This is why our kids need to understand. They need culture. They need cultural interaction. You know, a lot of times when we move into the suburbs or into the neighborhoods that are, you know, that there are not a lot of people like us, and our kids go to schools where there are like maybe two or three other Black kids who, and they might even be biracial or mixed or whatever, they don't get exposed to the culture. My friend, I have a friend, well, she passed away, and as well as actually her son did too. But years ago, her son went to a prep school where on the football team and on the basketball team, I think it was only one other Black student, and I think one was his cousin that was on the football team. But it was a preparatory school, and so the school was predominantly white. It was probably, I would say, 5% of the students who went there were Black, because it was very expensive, number one, and very few, you know, went there because it was not balanced. And I used to say to her all the time that he needs culture outside of school, because he was about the color of my shirt, but all of his friends, girlfriend, and ended up wife, and everybody in his life was white. It's like he had no connection to Black culture. And I thought that was an injustice to him, that he wasn't exposed. And I'm like, even if your kids go to school like that, you have to put them in other stuff so that they understand, and they're around kids who look like them and talk like them, got the thick lips and the big hair and the kinky curls and all of that stuff, because then otherwise they're going to think that they're different and that something's wrong with them and that they're ugly. Because, and I went through that. That was me when I was younger, and I thought that, you know, that I was ugly because my hair wasn't straight and stringy. And I wanted my hair to be like that. And I used to always want, you know, you used to put the towel on my head and, you know, pretend I had long hair. And it took me years. I am just finally in my late 30s and 40s that I even knew I had curly hair. I didn't know, because we permed it so much. And so I'm just happy to see that. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to go on a tangent.
Oh, no, but the narratives have been pushed that even now when they have to pass laws,
mm-hmm.
You know, so the narrative been pushed that, you know, your hair is not pretty unless it's long and, you know, and mm-hmm. it's silky, and that's not true. It's not true.
It's the other way around, baby.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, we applaud her, Black with Mark. And that little cutie pie can be comfortable in her own skin. All right, fellas, come on, take us to our last one.
Moving, moving, moving. We keep it moving.
All righty then, going to history. Y'all know we like to end with history. Dorothy Irene Height was an African-American civil rights and women's rights activist born on March 24, 1912 in Richmond, Virginia. Height spent her life fighting for civil rights and women's rights. The daughter of a building contractor and a nurse, Height moved with her family to Rankin, Pennsylvania in her youth. There she attended racially integrated schools. In high school, Height showed great talent as an orator. She also became socially and politically active, participating in anti-lynching campaigns. Height's skills as a speaker took her all the way to a national oratory competition. Winning the event, she was awarded a college scholarship. Height had applied to and been accepted to Barnard College in New York, but as the start of school neared, the college changed its mind about her admittance, telling Height that they had already met their quota for Black students. Undeterred, she applied to New York University, where she would earn two degrees, a bachelor's degree in education in 1930 and a master's degree in psychology in 1932. One of Hite's major accomplishments at the YWCA was directing the integration of all of its centers in 1946. She also established its Center for Racial Justice in 1965, which she ran until 1977. In 1957, Hite became the president of the National Council of Negro Women. Through the center and the council, she became one of the leading figures of the civil rights movement. Hite worked with Martin Luther King Jr., A. Philip Randolph, Roy Wilkins, Whitney Young, John Lewis, and James Farmer, sometimes called the Big Six of the Civil Rights Movement, on different campaigns and initiatives. In 2004, President George W. Bush gave Hite the Congressional Gold Medal. She later befriended the first African-American president of the United States, Barack Obama, who called her the godmother of the Civil Rights Movement. According to the New York Times, Hite died in Washington, D.C., on April 20th, 2010. On February 1st, 2017, the United States Postal Service kicked off Black History Month with the insurance of the Dorothy Hite Forever Stamp honoring her civil rights legacy. Yes, yes. I knew her story. So seeing her story is amazing. Seeing us, you know, us cover is amazing, because I used to be a part of the National Council for Negro Women in Daytona. I tried. That's all I can say. But I joined the organization. But sometimes, you know, it's like it takes a generation to really kind of push those initiatives. Because the sad thing about it is, the older people, like, they're all dying off. They were some fire starters. We look at Lewis and Maxine Waters and all of them jokers, they never let up. We don't have that like that in our generation. We're so scattered and I wouldn't say our generation, the generation behind us, but it was so long, and there's such a big gap between how they did things back then, and we became comfortable. Our generation became comfortable because of what our forefathers did. Right. And our generation behind us don't have a clue. Mm-hmm. And that's just where we are. So it's sad to see that. But we talked about her a lot in the organization when I became a part of it. So I was familiar with her life. So, all righty. Well, your thoughts?
I loved, one thing I did love about her, when I pulled up her pictures, man, she was a hat lady.
Oh, yeah.
And she loved purple. Seemed like she liked purple a lot. But she had all kinds of hats. I said, oh, man. I love that when I saw her. But she was amazing. I know I cater to our women a lot, because even with the movement, they even pushed, you know, we didn't hear a lot about women. Mm-hmm. I just didn't. When I was growing, I heard a lot about, you know, of course, Mega Evers, and you know, the list go on and on with men. But I wanted to really highlight some of the great contribution that women made, and they really have, really, yeah.
Women, I'm telling you, women have done some things, yeah. And you know, we should not undermine what women have done and the powerful things that women even have done and continue to do.
Continue.
So yeah, so it's great. So, all right, fellas. I was gonna say, fellas, take us to the next one. Ain't no next one. All right, good people. Thank you all so much for tuning in. But we have come to the conclusion. That was our last time topic. Actually, you know, it's our history topic. We do something from history every Wednesday at the end of our topics. But we're so glad that you stopped by, and you know, you could have gone anywhere else, but you hung out with us. Those of you who did, those of you who came on later, you can go back and watch it from the beginning. We got a whole lot of good stuff. Listen, our two time topics are always the love. But before we leave, we want to ask that you do a few things for us. The video that you're watching is either on Facebook or YouTube. Please make sure you subscribe, like, and share. Subscribe, like, and share. You can also sow a seed. Our Cash App is $MovementWorldwide. You can Zelle us at info@movementworldwide.org, or you can sow a seed by becoming a patron. Go to our website, movementworldwide.org, click the red button, and we'll take you to patreon.com. You can set up your account and set up your amount. We ask for $12 a month. That's 40 cents a day, $2.80 a week. That's one drink at one restaurant for the week out of all them meals that you eaten all week long. I know y'all going out, like those of you who go out and eat like 5 or 6 times a week.
Wow.
I'm just saying.
There's some people that do, though.
I know a lot of people who do. You know, some people.
Yeah.
A lot of people do. So please, ma'am, please, sir, sow a seed into Movement Worldwide. You can also, everywhere you see that globe above Annette's head, follow us on all social media platforms. That's us. You can also email us your thoughts, views, comments, prayers, reports, prayer requests, topic ideas to info@movementworldwide.org. Now let me give the rundown of what we have going on all week long. We start off on Tuesday nights, and Annette L. Anderson greets us with her presence from her organization, SOAR. You can find SOAR at Annette L. Anderson. That is AnnetteLAnderson.com. She and her husband, Leonard, they greet us with their presence with TNT with the Andersons. What is TNT? Well, I'm glad you asked. Wow. TNT. That's Tuesday Night Talk, where we take flight and soar. That speak, orate, articulate, and you did that earlier. I was like, well, I'm gonna steal it, mix it in with the Kevin. Where we speak, orate, articulate, and reverberate. That's every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. live on Facebook and YouTube. And then on Wednesdays, come right back here for this conversation, midweek conversation, where we let our hair down, have some fun, just a good old time, y'all. No big eyes, no little U's, just chilling, having our 3-4 conversation every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. live on Facebook and YouTube, starting off with those phrases, those topics, those quotes, those things that make you go, our transformational topic, then ripping the band-aid off, we have the power tool. Then we go from the good, bad, and ugly, keeping it light, but keeping it real, even giving you some history in the process with our tea time topics. That's Wednesday nights at 7 live right here. Then on Fridays, you've got to download the app. Somebody say, download the app. Boom, boom. Download the app. Say what? Download the app. Say what? Go to your app store and download Clubhouse. It's a little hand that waves. Clubhouse. Look for me. Look for Annette. Look for that globe. Find us. Join Clubhouse so that you can be in that room, the Movers and Shakers house, every Friday night at 8 p.m. This year's Operation Manifestation, with a different topic every week. But just in case you cannot get it, you can always text us, bam, the word movers to 954-820-5050. Have me a little intro.
Oh, that's the intro. Okay.
954-820-5050. Text the word movers to 954-820-5050. You will get a link into the room in progress, and you will also get notifications when we are live and when we have some great things going on. And then on Sundays, join us right back here on this platform live each and every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. for Power Walk Sunday, where we inspire and motivate you to walk into your God-given destiny with power and conviction, where there is always, say always, Annette.
Ways.
There is always a word for you. Your last thoughts?
Oh, right. And home. Well, Anita talked about home is where the heart is. That really blessed me. And when she said dwell means to live at a resident, as a resident. So we have to know that we have, there's a home here, like my husband always say, but we sojourners and we're heading somewhere. So I want to live, be excited and happy and be at peace in this home. And even when I get to my glory, the glory home. So, wow. Hey, just know. Yeah, that one I almost want to preach. Home is where the heart is.
Ah, so, yeah. you done preached a little bit right there.
Oh,
now.
My God.
I have to get you before we leave. Go out the door without
a... Oh, my God.
All right. So, without further ado, y'all, we are about to go. We love y'all. I'm so glad we had this time. together. But we got to go. All right. So we've given you the rundown, but now we're going to give y'all some hearts. Boom, boom, boom. We're going to give y'all some kisses. Mwah, 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 mwah. Give y'all some love. And we will see y'all the next time, the next place that we have something going on. Love y'all. Peace out. See y'all next time.
Bye.
Walk into your God-given destiny with power and conviction with Power Walk Sunday. Each and every Sunday at 10 a.m. live on multiple platforms.
When we eat well, we live well, and all will be well. Go to elbwell.com, join the journey, and take your life back. TNT, that's Tuesday Night Talk with the Andersons, each and every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. live on multiple platforms. For more information and other services, visit AnnetteLAnderson.com. Your faithful co-hosts, Annette and Anita, along with the best mods this side of heaven, are live on Clubhouse in the Movers and Shakers house with Operation Manifestation every Friday night at 8 p.m. You don't want to miss this fiery conversation. If you don't have your copy yet, get yours today at Amazon.com. That's Living Life One Quote at a Time by Annette L. Anderson. Another milestone reached. Get your copy of The Wow Effect by Anita Faye Wilson, available on all platforms, or you can visit AnitaFayeWilson.com. And you can always catch us live on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for Can We Talk? Join us with your Can We Talk coffee mug. Get yours today. They're $15 and that includes shipping. So good seed into good soil. You can sow a seed into Movement Worldwide via Cash App at $Movement Worldwide, Zelle at info@movementworldwide.org, or by becoming a patron. You can visit our website at movementworldwide.org, click the red button, go to patreon.com, and set up your account today. And remember to follow us on all platforms, like, subscribe, click that notification button, and don't forget to share.